everybody. Welcome to the Atheist Experience. I'm Matt Dillahunty. Joining me this week, Martin Wagner. That was John, our butler, who also does the Hand of the Almighty.
Hand of the Almighty,
so you don't have to say the dirty part of the song.
Oh, wait.
No, this is a family show, yeah.
Oddly enough, we're stuck with the white table today and at a weird angle. So not only is it difficult to... I mean, I don't even have to worry about my arms being in the way. Everything's at an odd angle. We're a little skewed after the Christmas war.
What is the reason for that? Why are we...
The other table's missing. But it's going to be hard to read stuff across the bottom, so I'll just rattle it off.
Oh, okay.
It's easy to do. Anyway, as I mentioned, we are live. Today is Sunday, December... I'm over here. Sunday, December 28th, 2008. This is the last show of this year. Oh. And I didn't catch the number at the beginning, but it's up around like 585.
585.
Was it? Yeah.
What is the one?
So, yes. And that doesn't mean there have actually been 585 shows. It just means that this is show number 585.
You just started a random count from...
It's 585 weeks since the first show.
The very first,
so when there's not a show on a specific week, we still give it a number.
Yeah.
I don't know who started that.
It works.
Hey,
why not?
What do we care? It's a live public access call-in television program. We'll have the number for you shortly. You'll be able to call in to talk about, well, pretty much since Martin's here, you can talk about whatever you want.
Okay.
We have people in the studio today. Yay. The war on Christmas is put on hold for another 11 months or so. New Year's is around the corner, and the ACA solstice/New Year's party is coming up this Friday, but I want to get the regular announcements out of the way, and then we'll start taking calls right off the bat. As I mentioned, it's a live show, and we are streaming it live over the internet. They'll put a link at the bottom. It's ustream.tv/whatever, and it's not up yet.
It's easiest to just go to atheist-experience.com.
Yeah, we're sponsored by the Atheist Community of Austin.
Click the link there.
A nonprofit education organization promoting positive atheism and the separation of church and state. For more information about the ACA, you can visit the ACA's website at www.atheist-community.org. There'll be a link there. That's that website. There'll be a link there to go to atheist-experience.com. That's the one for this show, and there's instructions there on how to connect to the Ustream link that was up before that. The audio portion of the show is available for download and as a podcast. And in addition to this program, the ACA also. It's hard to put like two A's together like
ACA
that.
ACA also? No.
No, that's all right. ACA also sponsors a bi-weekly internet audio podcast called The Nonprofits. That's P-R-O-P-H-E-T-S. You can, for more information, go to nonprofitsradio.com. That's hosted by Dennis LeBay. It features myself, Russell Glasser, Schilling, and Jeff D is back. And Jeff D will be in the regular, well, Jeff D's not back on The Nonprofits regularly. He was there to close out this last year.
Oh, all right.
Came in special, but
coming
he will
back
be
from
back.
His little hiatus.
Yeah, well, he's still working, but he's back in the regular co-host rotation on this show, and his first Atheist Experience show is the January 11th episode.
Excellent.
So 2 weeks from today, Jeff D will be right there.
In this
call
chair.
In and tell him he's going to
yelling
hell.
At you. So tune in because it's always fun when he's on.
Dennis.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Dennis.
What about Dennis?
You didn't mention Dennis on the.
I did.
Yes,
I said
did.
It's hosted by Dennis LeBay. If you're not going to listen to everything I say...
We've just been incorrectly corrected from the peanut gallery here.
That's okay. So
thank you. Right.
We're kind of just winging it because I didn't actually prepare anything. I know Martin didn't prepare anything.
Oh, no, wait a minute. Just because every other time I've come on the show, I've just been like, I have nothing to talk about. Let's take calls.
You have something to talk about?
Well, in brief, yes.
No, not yet.
Oh.
But you have something.
I do.
Well, let me get this out of the way then.
Well, then fine.
The ACA is a nonprofit educational organization promoting positive atheism and separation of church and state. It has weekly meetings every Sunday at Romeo's in Barton Springs Road beginning at around 11:30, except for the first Sunday of the month when we host a lecture series at the Austin History Center located at the corner of 9th and Guadalupe. We have a number of events throughout the week, throughout the month, throughout the year, including the solstice/New Year's party that'll be January 2nd. That one's for members only, or friends of members, or guests of members, or people who think they know members and want to get in. You can visit the website for more information and get an RSVP in to Mike Swift, who's hosting it. And every Thursday at the Dog and Duck Pub at 17th and Guadalupe, we host Atheist Happy Hour, beginning at around 7 o'clock and ending when people want to go home. When this program's over, everybody involved gets together and goes out to dinner at Threadgill's on 301 West Riverside Drive. It's right there at the bottom of your screen. Any atheist or atheist-friendly person is welcome to come to any of our events. You don't have to be a member to attend. You don't have to sacrifice your firstborn or even be mean. You can just show up and have fun. The lecture series is on the first Sunday of every month. That begins at around 12:30. I don't know who the next lecturer is. I'm not even sure if we've got one scheduled. If not, we'll make something up as usual. That's it. That's all the announcements
all
I really need.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I pretty much covered everything.
Yeah, rapid fire. Those people who complain that I go on for 10 minutes with announcements, today you got five, and it was mostly, you know, us having fun.
Well, so the phone lines are...
Yes.
Do you want to go ahead and talk to our first three callers? Because my thing can just be at any point in the show. It doesn't have to be the centerpiece. It doesn't have to...
All right, we're taking calls then.
Yes.
We're getting... Hey, this is Nick?
Yes.
In Maryland?
Yes, Nick from Maryland.
How you doing?
I'm doing well. I just had kind of a quick kind of personal question. I was born in a Catholic family, and while in high school, I had to go through the whole CCD thing. And my mom basically forced me to get confirmed. But, you know, in the past couple of years, I came out and said I was an atheist, and it's really been hurting the relationship between a couple of my siblings and especially my mom, to the point where this past week when I was visiting home and it came up that she said that she didn't even want to hear the word atheist. And I was just kind of wondering what your opinion or advice would be on helping to make it so that it doesn't, my relationship, my family doesn't degenerate further.
Did you tell her you didn't want to hear the word God?
No.
I didn't either. I just got back from visiting with family, and of course, actually it was mostly great. Had a good time, and I'm not going to go talking trash about my family, but there was some there were some comments made that were pro-religious, anti-atheist, or I guess more anti-sin from their perspective. Mm-hmm. I don't know, but you know, I keep saying that, you know, now I can be honest about who I am, and I don't have to hide anything, and I don't have to sit quietly in the corner and keep my mouth shut. And yet, for the most part, I still find that I'm now, instead of nodding and smiling and sitting quietly, now I just shake my head and walk away. It's still their house. I'm not going to be, you know, disrespectful or an ass in their house. But there are limits when you start talking about, you know, things that I think are just crazy. I mean, and I don't mean to offend any religious people that are out there, although I will, and I have done every week that I've been on this show, I'm sure. But I'm not saying that religious people are crazy. I'm saying, you know, I think that there are some people who there may even be somebody there who has a really good reason for believing. And if so, feel free to call in and tell us what it is. But there are some things that some particular people believe that I think are just absolutely nuts. This idea that you are somehow so special in the eyes of your God that he's going to punish other people for being mean to you, or that he's going to answer your prayer for rain and ignore the farmer who lives across the street who's wanting it to stop raining because it's flooding out his field. That kind of colossal arrogance.
Well, yeah,
drives
it's, I mean,
me
it's
nuts.
Incredibly amusing every time you tune in some stupid television show and there's some vapid pop singer up there accepting an award.
Yes.
Thanking God for it.
Yes.
Like, I'm the creator of the universe, and he really gives a damn about my career. Oh, I'll just stop creating this galaxy here for a few minutes just to make sure that your crappy CD shoots to number one, and you can thank me later.
Yeah.
This whole thing, that's what really is at the key of religion, at the core of it all. It's this whole attitude of it's all about me.
Yeah,
everything's all about me when you're religious. You know,
and it's a lot of posturing too. I mean, I noticed
and
a lot
say,
of
no,
those.
No, it's not about me. It's about God. But God is just a projected self-image of the believer.
Oh yeah,
that's really all that
and
God
that's,
is.
And that's why I mean, Christianity is as easy as it comes. I mean, you know, it's based and I realize that you didn't necessarily. I mean, you're talking about Catholics, but Christianity for the most part is based on just you believe, and therefore you're gifted something. You don't have to do anything. It'd be nice if you did good things, but you don't have to. You can be a shit your whole life and still get, you know, ushered in because you were part of the club, the special club. And that allows people to go up and do all kinds of posturing. And you'll see, I mean, preachers will complain about it too. You'll have the rapper who'll get up there and thank Jesus and all his hoes in the hood, you know, for helping him get to the top when neither one of them really had anything to do with it. You should be thanking the record company execs and the marketing campaign, I guess. But we're way off track.
Yeah, we're kind of getting.
You were talking about dealing with family. I don't have any good advice, which is probably why we got way off track.
Yeah.
I wish I did, and your family's going to be different from everybody else's.
Yeah, all I could suggest in that regard is to say, look, I understand that this upsets you, and I'm sorry about it, but it's who I am, and if you ever want to ask me any questions, feel free, because, you know, you're my family and I love you, and so I'm not going to turn against you just because I don't share the same beliefs that you have, and I would hope that you would feel the same way towards me, and so, and just be willing to talk about your decision to be an unbeliever and answer any questions that they might have. You know, they're being the unreceptive ones, and that's because they have this religious belief that is really, when you get right down to brass tacks, it's all about kind of fear and insecurity. You don't have that, so you can be the open, magnanimous one, willing to be receptive to the family that right now is kind of scared of you, or scared of what they think you've become. Once they realize that you're not really any different of a person, you're still the same family member they've always had, you've just decided to jettison religion from your life, you know, they may, who knows, they may come around, they may not. I have a rather strange relationship with my parents in that the whole religion thing is just kind of a thing we agree not to talk about in an unspoken way. My mother really genuinely truly believes in these places called heaven and hell that you go to after you die in some form. And it is a great source of profound emotional trauma to her to contemplate the idea that her little boy is going to burn forever in hell, which, you know, for my part, is just one more, chalks up just one more reason for me to be incredibly resentful towards Christianity, because it has installed this completely unnecessary, gratuitous fear in her life, this source of, you know, emotion that she simply doesn't need. But I just don't bring the subject up. We don't bring it up with each other. She doesn't have to kind of experience those emotions, and, you know, and that's where it sits. It is a shame that, but it's a shame that religion does that. That's what religion does. It divides people. And so you can be the, you know, you can, as atheists, we're in a better position to be the one willing to and able to bridge that divide than a believer is. So that's my take.
Can I ask you something real quick, Nick? Do your parents or whoever the believers are that you're having conflict with, do they give any reason for why they believe in a God?
No.
Okay.
Kind of when I try to go down that road, it turns into a, I don't want to talk about this, you're wrong.
Yeah.
If you don't change, you're going to go to hell kind of thing.
Yeah. You know, it's rare that you'll find anybody who says that they believe for rational reasons. I mean, they may start that way. I mean, even some of the more popular apologists will start that way. And then when you get them narrowed down, eventually they're backed into a corner where it becomes a faith thing, or it becomes a, well, I've had experiences and I've felt God's presence in my life, and therefore God has revealed himself to me, and I know that it is true, even if I can't demonstrate it to you. That's where you normally get them to get back to. And having, if the conversation comes up, and it may be better just to you know, love them and keep showing them that you're pretty much the same kid that they raised, that they've always known and loved, and that, you know, you're not going to be swayed just because somebody's trying to guilt trip you, or that the very fact that they're feeling distraught over this is just one more nail in the coffin for their religion in your eyes. But if you get them to the point where they're willing to say that this is an experiential thing for them, as I was able to do when they were unable to make any headway through the various logical fallacies and versions of Pascal's wager that they threw my way, I basically said, look, you believe that there is a God. And you believe that this God wants me to be saved and go up to heaven. And the reason you believe all this is because God has specifically revealed it to you. You are sure because you've had some experience. Then the best thing you could ever do is stop preaching at me and stop arguing with me over silly things and logical fallacies, and start praying that your God would reveal himself to me. Because if it ever happens, it's not like I'm going to go, oh, you don't exist. I might say, oh, you're an ass, and you've got some explaining to do, and I'm not going to worship you. That's a separate question. Belief in whether or not you're going to, you know, become a follower is they're two different issues. But I'm not going to deny the existence of something. Now, what I would do is say that, okay, if this God revealed himself to me, it would be a case of, okay, now I've had this experience that I can't necessarily explain, but for whatever reason, I'm convinced that there is a God. I may not be a fan of his. But I can't prove it to anybody else, and I couldn't possibly expect anybody else to believe as well until they've had a similar experience. It's, I mean, I'm not even sure I can come up with a good analogy for it, but I mean, if their basis like many Christians when backed into that faith corner, is that they've had experience that they are convinced is a God, then, well, you haven't had that experience. And until you do, they should not expect you to believe as they do.
Mm-hmm. All right. I mean, that's pretty much the way it's been going so far for me. So
I wish I could say it gets better. It may or may not.
Yeah.
It's kind of hit or miss. I tell you one thing that does help, though, and then we'll head up some other callers. Find an atheist group in your area. I mean, we exist. Sure, we've got the TV show and the podcast, and we debate and discuss issues and everything else. But the ACA, in addition to being an educational corporation, is also a social group. So that people who have spent their lives feeling ostracized from perhaps their very own families, that you would think would love them unconditionally, have a place to go with people. I mean,
no family works that
way. We are, yes. That's the biggest lie. The first, the biggest lie is that there's a God, and the second biggest lie is that you're going to get unconditional love from anybody.
Except
the
dog.
Except the dog. I know. If you stop feeding it and start kicking it, I don't know.
Yeah. But that's your fault.
Yeah.
I'll see if I can't find a group or something around. I'm kind of hoping when I start grad school in January that I'll meet some intelligent people or something.
Yeah. I hope so if you're in grad school.
And if there isn't a group in your area, get on Craigslist and make one. Just say, hi, I'm an atheist. I'd like to meet other local atheists. Let's get together at such and such a joint and have a pitcher of beer and meet. And, you know, we didn't do it over a pitcher of beer. It was like bagel shop thing. But that's how ACA started. And now ACA is a very influential organization. So you never know, little acorns.
Well, I'll
let
you guys get to the other
callers,
and thank you very much.
Thanks, Nick. Yeah. We got Blake in New York. Blake in New York, you're on the air.
Hi, you still there?
Oh, thank you. I just want to say that I think that you guys are doing very important work. A lot of people, I'm from New York, of course, up in a lot of people, who aren't brought up in a religious community, they think that it's like kind of this like kind of novelty, kind of fringe thing. And it's just as severe in New York, in many areas of New York, as it is in a lot of the South and the rest of the country. I'm spending the holidays right now in North Carolina, Wilmington, North Carolina. And I came on to say a couple of things. One, that I think you guys are just doing very important work and that it needs to be done.
Thanks.
I have a really funny apologetic. I met a friend of mine who was a fundamentalist extremist and a political anarchist, and I said, that's a strange combination of ideals. And I started asking him all kinds of questions, and I asked him, so you really believe that the world was drained and flooded in 40 days, and that Noah was able to transport all 10 billion species of animals onto their correct various locations on the globe? And he said to me, well, perhaps God used a vortex or black hole type device to put all of the animals inside the ark.
Oh, that's awesome! That's
so there's an invisible black hole or vortex between Mount Ararat.
It's like the Dungeons and Dragons, the bag of holding, where you can just a little bag that you can just keep stuffing a million things into.
Yeah, it is like a bag of holding. I actually said that to him because he was entertaining.
That's the boat. The boat's like a bag of holding. Yeah. But
it's funny, but the reason I really came on was I have a short message that I have to say, and it's addressing that even passive belief is dangerous to a functioning society, and that a lot of I basically say I know that there's a fine line between healthy debate and reverse evangelizing. I know that it's difficult to hold the mantle of live and let live when we refuse to just ignore believers who commit unconstitutional and sometimes borderline treasonous acts on behalf of their faith. However, this is a message to those believers and non who think that the radical fringe calls attention to itself and gives passive believers a bad name. I'm here to claim that any such belief, passive or radical, is downright dangerous for a healthy and civilized society. The claim that passive belief isn't hurting anyone and should just be ignored is, to me, enabling and encouraging delusion. I know the D word is instantly offensive to a Christian, but I am using it in its dictionary definition to describe a phenomena. Quote, a false, persistent belief maintained in spite of evidence to the contrary. No, I'm not claiming that there is evidence to disprove God, but there is another type of evidence that we frivolously take for granted and that we see proven to us all the time, the presence of gravity and the absence of vampires. A normal, skeptical human mind cannot conclude anything with absolute certainty. This closes the mind off to being wrong. Being wrong is the single most important thing, not only for our growth, but for our survival. Without accepting that we were once wrong to stick our fingers in a light socket as a toddler is why we're still around. We also, hopefully, had a loving and rational parent to reinforce the correction. This micro-society, the household, represents a healthy and functional environment. Both parent and toddler can safely conclude that it is unsafe to stick their finger in the light socket, even without the knowledge of an electrician, because there is still evidence based on observation and experience. The next time you stick your finger in a socket, raspberry jam could come out. It's possible, but you aren't going to base your behavior and decisions on what's possible, only what's probable. My point is gravity and how offensively we take it for granted. Most of us make every decision under the assumption that gravity is going to do its job. We don't think for a second that gravity's rules will simply stop applying. We also don't entertain the possibility because of how vastly improbable it is. Gravity has done its job 100% of the time since the beginning of time, so that corroborating evidence is enough to not only conclude that it'll continue to work, but not to alter behavior or take preventative measures in case it doesn't. Herein lies the problem with a theist mentality, even a passive one. There are people who do ignore gravity. There are people who hurl themselves off of buildings because they're convinced beyond any doubt that the great blue unicorn will fly them away to Candy Mountain. Of course, when he hits the pavement and dies, the society circles around the body and unanimously agrees that this man was crazy and delusional. We come to a consensus as a rational people. The same thing should happen when it comes to claims of a virgin birth and walking on water. But we, on a massive scale, not only enable but encourage that belief by the hundreds of millions. The man on the roof ignored the staggering evidence that supported gravity. But more specifically, he inserted an irrational variable into an otherwise rational thought process. The variable, the one based on faith, actually caused him harm. Christians on any level, whether or not they know it, are doing the same thing. It is possible that the claims in the Bible are true, just as possible as it is that a vampire will bite you in your sleep. If both beliefs are faith-based and both ignore clear evidence of things like gravity and physics with no evidence, neither argument is any more or less valid than the other. However, you will take preventative measures to save yourself from hell, but you won't take preventative measures against something just as probable like a vampire.
I completely agree with you, but this is no longer a short message.
Yeah, this is...
I'm sorry. I should have timed it.
Yeah,
it's almost done. Should I stop now?
Well, just because, you know, it's just for the sake of television.
I got full Collins, and I don't disagree with you on any of the points at all.
Yeah, I think you've made a terrific point. It's going on a little bit long for the purpose of the program, but...
Which brings me to one other thing, and I'm gonna go ahead and let you go, Blake. I appreciate the call, but we got people waiting on the line from other places, and I want to make one quick point, but I'm agreeing with you there, and I thank you for calling. I really do. We're trying to cut down on the number of calls from people who agree with us. Streaming the show out over the internet is something that we've done so that people don't necessarily have to wait for the podcast, and there's interaction. There's a chat room on there where you can talk. We start broadcasting before the show starts so people can call in and ask questions and interact ahead of time. That's all great.
And don't get us wrong. We love the calls from all the folks who are like, good job, you know, you're doing great.
Don't necessarily stop calling, but most of you started liking this show because of the conversations with
the believers,
people who disagree with us,
yeah,
the contentious calls, the ones where we, you know, mm-hmm. why don't we die when the sun goes down? Mm-hmm. I'm not necessarily saying we want bad apologists calling mm-hmm. in, and we definitely don't want to stop the calls from people who agree with us. But we got to keep them short and move on, especially we have three phone lines, and if they're tied up with people from out of town who want to call in to say good job and I agree with you and here's my take on it, then we're not going to get the guy who's calling in to explain why he believes in a God.
And it's just to turn up their long-distance fees or their minutes or whatever they're using. So
that said, we have a theist, I believe, from out of town. So it's Harley in Toronto.
Harley, are you with us?
Yeah.
Hi.
Hey, welcome. Thanks for waiting.
You're on the air. Thank you.
Okay.
How you doing?
Good. Yeah, I'm just going to take my headset off because I'm watching it on the computer and it's a bit delayed.
Yeah,
that's fine.
All right, so I just want to make a response to what the last caller was saying, and then I can get into my point.
Okay.
Yeah, okay, keep it short, please.
He was saying that we were, like, taking response, or, like, taking stuff to protect ourselves from hell and vampires. I'd just like to say there are many theists out there who are extreme, but for every extreme person, there are unextremes. So I just thought you might want to think about that.
Okay.
Well, yeah. Well, I mean, we know that not every believer in whatever ideology they believe is a radical. We know we're aware of that.
His larger point, his larger point on some level was that those of you who aren't extreme are still providing cover and for the irrational beliefs of those who are extreme, and that your beliefs are no more supported than theirs are. But I'll let you get to your point.
Right. Well, I don't believe in like Noah's Ark and stuff like that, and I have a bit of trouble believing that Jesus resurrected, but you say that he never even walked, and there are...
No, I didn't say that.
No.
No, I didn't.
No.
I've never said that. As a matter of fact, I've corrected the same stupid point about 53,000 times.
Yeah. There are atheists who take that view, but Matt and I are not among them.
What I've said is that there is insufficient evidence to support that he actually did exist. I'm not saying he didn't. What I'm talking about is when you try to determine whether or not somebody existed, you have to take an assessment of what you know about them. And when you build this character story, for example, George Washington, we take everything that we've heard about George Washington, we try to find out what of it's true. And when there's a good chunk of it that's true, we can say, you know what, this person most likely probably existed, although there's one or two things like the I chopped down a cherry tree, I cannot tell a lie story, that are pretty much mythical, and we throw that out and say that probably didn't happen. In the case of Jesus, there is not a single contemporary account from an eyewitness. There is not a single event from his life that we can accurately date or provide any evidence for. And all of the accounts are done a generation later or more. They are hearsay by non-eyewitnesses. And the accounts of his life, the events that we would try to identify, are almost all of a supernatural nature. They have no verification. That's what I've said. I've said repeatedly, there may very well have been, as a matter of fact, I think it's likely that there may have been some itinerant Jewish rabbi or teacher named Yeshua around that period of time that is essentially the core of the story. But what the Bible records of his life and words and deeds, there's nothing, no evidence to say that that is reliable.
Yeah. Do you understand the distinction there?
Yeah. But okay. I believe in an episode back you were saying that he was a legend.
Let me give you an example of how these things can develop from a, you know, if you're going back to antiquity, right? You ought to read some books dating back to that period. Some of the histories of the Roman Empire, for example. A really entertaining book is called The 12 Caesars by a writer named Suetonius, who essentially wrote this collection of biographies of the first 12 Roman emperors from Augustus onward. Not only is it a terrific, very entertaining book to read, but what you will find in his histories is that because of the mentality and the beliefs that were common among even intellectuals of his day, he will report on things like omens, okay, and divine visitations or signs, what have you. And these will be taken seriously, and these were taken seriously by people of their day. For example, Roman generals and the emperors, people leading the troops into battle. Stories would circulate among, you know, the legionnaires and the centurions about how, you know, a hawk came down from the sky and circled the general's head three times and, you know, took a poop on his helmet, and this signifies whatever. Or they would read the entrails of a goat. This kind of stuff was taken seriously back then. Curses were taken seriously. Divinations were taken seriously. And he incorporates a lot of this supernatural content into what is, for the most part, a very straightforward history of the first 12 Roman emperors. Now, it doesn't mean that these days we pretty much are fairly confident these kinds of supernatural occurrences don't really exist. But when you have a culture that is seeped in those kinds of beliefs, this kind of boundary between fantasy, reality, what have you, blurs. And so it is no wonder that a similar story or set of stories might emerge from a figure like Jesus, an itinerant Jewish rabbi who developed a following, became something of a rabble-rouser, a thorn in Rome's side, as it were. And from that point on, the legend kind of develops. So it's not to say that the character, the person himself, Jesus Christ or Yeshua or whatever his original name is, was not a historical person in any way, shape, or form. But what it means is, like a lot of the stories that were circulating about Roman generals and emperors and other famous people of the day, the reality of his life got mingled in with myth and legendary, and people would just build the stories and build upon them, and that's essentially what happens.
All that aside, and I'll let you get back to whatever you were saying, all that aside, the specific case that you're talking about, I was referencing C.S. Lewis's argument that the Lewis trilemma, that Jesus is either liar, lunatic, or Lord. And my only point was that he left off another L option, which is legend. It's there as an option. I didn't say which one I necessarily accept. I think I lean more towards lunatic.
Well, I believe you have just defeated me.
Cool.
I will be back.
Have a nice day.
Feel free to call back anytime you have something else. I mean, I'm sure there are plenty of areas where we disagree, and you know. But I'm glad at least we cleared it up, that you're not sitting there thinking that I'm asserting that, you know, Jesus never existed. I'm not doing that, and I'm not saying there absolutely is no God and I know this. I wouldn't say that. What I'd say is there's probably not a God. I see no evidence for one, and until somebody gives me reason to, I'm not believing.
Well, just as long as you don't completely disrespect me, and I'll see you.
Thanks, Harley.
Take care.
Appreciate it.
Of course we don't disrespect you.
Just don't happen to agree. And anybody who's
amazing,
you know,
how that works.
Yeah,
you can disagree in this world.
We got, is it Ed here in Austin?
Hello, Ed.
Are you there, Ed?
Ed.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello. Is this Ed in Austin?
Yeah.
How you doing?
I'm all right. How are you?
We're good. What's up?
Well, I've heard Martin say at the beginning of the show something that I considered to be a pretty harsh generalization when he said that. That's basically what religion is, speaking of being something that is selfish and that teaches selfishness. And I think you were referring to a prayer where the farmer, you know, needs rain and somebody prays for not rain, and some stupid selfish prayer. And, you know, I take issue with that. I think you overgeneralize. I think there's a lot of honest religion in the world, and, you know.
Can you define honest religion?
That's what I was going to ask. Yeah.
Yeah, well, I would say a religion where it is, you know, someone realizes that they don't know everything, that, you know, the Bible in the science book.
I agree.
And, yeah, I mean, I'm sure you're going to agree with a lot of things I say.
Well, if that's all there is to honest religion, then I'm an honest religion here.
Yeah, we're all for it.
Well, that's not all that an honest religion is. I mean, you can have faith without certainty, and you know, there's also the freedom to interpret for yourself and not, or to have nature, God, or whatever word, you know, is not offensive to you, have that speak to you and, you know, learn without, you know, it all being about some dogma, somebody else's dogma, some antiquated fairy tale thing.
That's right. By the way, you're talking about natural religion, more or less, and I agree. A lot of people do that, and that's all well and good. But I still think that one of the points that I made earlier, which is that religion is simply a way for the believer to either project themselves or a certain, shall we say, set of desires, you know, how they would like life to be, upon the world around them. That's essentially what you're talking about, and I don't see any real variance there in terms of the point that I was making.
I'd say
it was a generalization, and it sounded a little harsh, and
I didn't mean to make it sound that way, but at the same time, you have to admit that you do see that kind of behavior all the time among you have what city was it, the governor of, or the mayor of Birmingham or something, who they were having a drought, and they all got around on the steps of the either the Capitol or what have you, and was it Alabama? Someone can clear that. They prayed for rain publicly because they were having a drought.
Well, there are a lot of anecdotal examples of exploitative religion.
Ed, can you hear me? Can you hear me, Ed?
What?
Hang on just a second. I don't need any anecdotal examples. Religion is selfish. It is selfish and arrogant in every form I've ever seen, because it props the person up with this delusion that they are somehow special, that they can get in tune with something that they have no evidence or reason to believe even exists in the first place. To me, that is arrogant and selfish. I don't care if it's a natural religion where you're just trying to get in tune with some higher power. The idea that there is a higher power is something that needs to be justified, and the idea that it would communicate with you elevates you up to this level. There is something, and I'm not saying, there are plenty of people who are religious, who are very good, generous people, who don't appear to be selfish and probably don't realize that they have any selfish motivations. We are all selfish. Religious or not religious, we are all selfish on some level. We are out to do what's best for us. And in the case where some people think that a religion is going to better them, make them better, improve their lives, that's still selfish. And so I think the generalization holds.
Well, okay, now you said that everyone is selfish. Can I talk for a second?
Yeah.
Without being interrupted? Do you want to have an
I can hang up on your ass just like that. Whoops, did.
Yeah.
Yeah. You can call back, Ed, if you want to. I was happy to let you talk.
I was wanting to hear what the kind of nutty thing was going to... You know, the point is, yes, this is what I was talking about. Religion is the way in which believers project themselves,
I think I'll make Ed's points for him. I think I'll make Ed's points for him by saying that everybody is selfish. It's not necessarily religion that is selfish. It's people that are selfish, and that selfishness is demonstrated
in some
way.
The people make the religion.
By religion. However, I'd say that religion represents a particular selfish pursuit of ours. That not everything that we do is selfish, and this is the distinction between what Ed's saying and what I'm saying. Not everything that we do is selfish, but the broader idea that is at the core of many religious pursuits, that is selfish. The fact that you can also manifest your generosity and your altruism and things like that, and that goes along with religion too. Yeah, so if you want to say that it's an unfair generalization, fine. I'm easy.
Well, everyone's motivated by self-interest to a certain degree. I think that religion, again, because it is that form of projection, is just the apex of that sort of self-interest.
Yeah.
People follow it because they want something, right? And either they want a way to cheat death, or they simply want a way to manage their basic insecurities about life, or they want a nice prize from God or whoever they believe in after they die. They want to go to some sort of paradise. They want 72 verses. Whatever it is, ultimately people choose religions and practice religions because they want something. They expect to get something out of the experience. If you didn't expect to get something out of the experience, you wouldn't go to these revivals or these churches and sing hymns and do whatever it is that you do in your... Or you wouldn't pray. Yeah. What is prayer? Prayer is you're asking some divine being that you believe in for something. You're asking for something. The same God who supposedly can't interfere with free will and can't interfere with human affairs whenever you're dealing with the great evils of the world... Whenever you want to talk about the problem of evil, suddenly this God can't interfere in human affairs because he doesn't want to subvert our free will in any way. But suddenly you turn around and you need something and you pray to this same God. You're expecting him to interfere in your affairs. You know, people are religious because they want something. Everybody wants something in life, and religion is just...
That's an overgeneralization, Martin.
Fine. It also happens to be right.
Yeah, it may be the case. And it also might be, you could say that people are religious in some cases because that's the way they're born and raised and they don't know any different. They've always done this. But on some level, the continued practice of this or in any... Okay, fine. Give an example of a non-selfish reason, a non-selfish motivation for whatever religious practice, whatever, that you think is not selfish. Yeah. And, I'll move you to the head of the list, and you can call back, and I won't hang up. We've got, is it Andrew?
Yeah.
In Kansas, how you doing?
Thanks for waiting.
I'm good. How are you?
Good.
This is my first time calling. I'd like to discuss, my personal quest. I think, a quest that all atheists share in some sorts. It differs for every person, but I think in a general sense it's the same. So, do you mind if I... talk about that?
Sure.
Yeah.
Try and keep it a little brief.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think the first step to this quest, I want to call, you've mentioned it before, it's other people, come in at different ways. For you, it was, I think, 1 Peter 3:15, is that what, it's always be ready to defend your faith, is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay, and, for me personally, it was, I never... really bought into, religion, but, I took a special interest in, philosophy, and it kind of led me to religion, and eventually, if you're a rational person, and, you look at the evidence, and you don't try to fool yourself, you know, to, you know, to false claims. You come at the realization that, you know, the belief in a God is trivial, you know, it's not supported by evidence. And from there, you reach a crossroad, and I think that's like the most important part, and that this crossroad is what defines you. I think the two roads are nihilism and existentialism. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
And like, a lot of people don't really choose nihilism because, you know, a nihilistic worldview is not, you know, a positive one. It's kind of pointless. But existentialism, I've heard you talk about it before on the show, putting value in like, you know, your loved ones, what makes you happy. And what I'm talking about, what defines you as a person is, you know, what makes you happy. Is it making other people happy? Is it just making yourself happy? And I think that's that really where, you know, if you can call yourself a good person or a bad person, or I don't believe in all this, you know, people are bad by nature. I believe people have the potential to do bad, but what defines you is if, you know, you choose to do bad or if you choose not to do bad. But I don't, you know, when people say, you know, I'm bad by nature, I need to repent for my sins, I think that's a bunch of bullshit.
Well, I think I have I think I know what you're getting at. What we were talking about just now about how people are essentially motivated by self-interest, yeah. And you're saying a similar thing, whereas, you know, people are defined, your personality is defined by what makes you happy. For most people, I think that what you learn just through the routine experience of living your life is that what makes you happy and that what is the most beneficial and useful thing to you is to get along with everyone. Is to not be someone who is antisocial and constantly causing problems and turning people against you. We're social beings, ultimately. That's the nature of our species. And so, whereas I think people have... I think we lost him.
I didn't do that.
Yeah, sorry. I think that was on your end. Whereas a lot of people certainly look out for number one, ultimately what you learn is, you know, it's the best happiness comes from having friends, having family, having colleagues, being the sort of person that contributes well to your community, tries to leave a good legacy behind, so that when other people talk about you and think of you, and they say, you know, that guy was a good guy, and that's the end of it. I mean,
I'm more worried about whether or not I think I'm a good guy personally.
Well,
I mean, I think the rest of it will take care of itself. But yeah. You know, if I think I'm a good guy, I'm okay with that. As long as I'm not hurting other people, and you know, people, I'm sure they'll tell me if I am.
Yeah.
When I'm not.
I think most people tend to think, yeah, I'm a good guy because other people, I get that feedback from others.
Ed's back. You there, Ed?
Hello, Ed.
Hello.
Is this Ed?
Yeah, I'm here.
Hi.
Hey, mine's Chris. I had a...
Oh, Chris.
You're not Ed.
Hi.
No, I'm someone else. Is that okay?
No, that's great, yeah.
Sure.
I wasn't sure if I was going to get on or not, but this is the first time I've called. I just recently found you guys on the internet, and I think you guys are doing an awesome job. And I know you had talked about not calling and agreeing, although I do agree with you. I thought maybe I'd argue for a friend of mine.
Sure.
I don't believe you.
No, I'm serious. I'm serious.
Give him a shot.
Go ahead.
Come on.
All right.
Be a sport.
Okay, well, basically, a good friend of mine who was the guy who originally, I guess you could say, converted me or helped me find Christ, back in, you know, 2001 after 9/11, him and I have stayed in contact ever since then, and I've gone through somewhat of like a teetotaling period since then. And I read The God Delusion about 2 or 3 months ago, and then along with that, some stuff about myths in the Bible, and I've pretty much come to an agreement with the tenets of atheism. But what he would
Except
argue...
Except there aren't any, but...
No,
well,
you know what he means, generally.
I got you.
What he would argue is, first of all, he's an old earth creationist, where he stands, but he believes that Genesis is kind of an anthropomorphic telling, but Genesis 2, he believes that Adam and Eve were real people, and that people walked with dinosaurs, which makes it kind of difficult for me to talk with him, because I see some conflicts there. The method in which scientists use to date fossils, he says, is wrong for the most part.
And what can he bring to bear to support that?
He's not an old earth creationist, then. If he thinks men walk with dinosaurs and that radiocarbon dating is wrong and the, and fossil dating is wrong, basically he's a young Earth creationist who just doesn't want to say the Earth's only 6 to 10,000 years old. He wants to have his cake and eat it too.
Yeah. That's kind of the point that I'm trying to make to him. Mm-hmm. He says that the older it's an old Earth, old universe, based upon good reason, you know, evidence that, you know, points that direction, mostly that have to do with the Big Bang. But then he wants to stick to the idea that Adam and Eve are real people, and that Genesis 2 is literal, based upon the idea that we need the teaching of the fall in order to explain evil.
Well, then he's just wrong about everything, frankly. I mean, we don't need the teaching of the fall to explain evil.
He's picking and choosing.
Yeah, he is simply believing what he wants to believe and making excuses rather than presenting actual evidence for that. And you're essentially dealing with someone who has an irrational set of beliefs, so of course you're going to have a great deal of difficulty trying to have
reasonable discussions. So how would I go about pointing that out to him without...
Get him to defend his side of things. If he thinks that the means that scientists use to date, for example, fossils and other archaeological and paleontological evidence is wrong, get him to display his expertise on that. Say, okay, first off, what means are they using that you think are wrong, and why are they wrong? Why is radioisotope dating wrong? Why is nuclear dating wrong? Show me, like, go right down into the physics of it, and show how it is that we cannot use these methods to determine the age of an artifact.
I'd also ask him to
defend his position, because he's the guy who's wrong. You don't have to defend anything.
I'd also ask him what justification he has to ignore Genesis 1 and then take Genesis 2 literally.
Yeah.
And I did talk to him about that. He uses some... I don't know if you've heard of Meredith Klein, but Meredith Klein, like, describes different things that go on in the Old Testament as basically different... perversions of the truth, like different pagan myths and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. And he uses that same argument when it comes down to Genesis 1 and Genesis 2, where Genesis 1 is anthropomorphic, but Genesis 2 is literal because
he wants it to be.
And right, exactly, because he feels he needs it to be.
Yeah. The Bible is the big book of multiple choice. Just remember that. Anytime you're dealing with an apologist, they will pick and choose the bits of it that they think will validate their arguments, and the other bits of it that you point to them and say, well, what about this? They're like, oh, well, that's... like, for example, you know how whenever you bring up anything sort of reprehensible about the Bible, you know, and Christians will always say, oh, well, that's just Old Testament. You know, Jesus came along and gave us a new covenant, so all that Old Testament stuff doesn't matter anymore. That's just the Old Testament. But we still want the Ten Commandments in schools.
Right.
So, you know, the Old Testament matters when it matters, and when it doesn't matter, or when it can shown to be really stupid and reprehensible, then suddenly, oh, well, that's just the Old Testament. So remember that. Bible's the big book of multiple choice.
That's something I try to point out to him that, you know, and the reason why I like talking to him so much is because he's not a stupid Christian. I mean, right now he's in school and seminary and everything else. And so I take his, you know, what he has to say seriously, because he takes, you know, the truth serious too. But I guess one of the other problems that I have with when I'm pointing out the fact that not just the Old Testament but the New Testament, the Bible in general, isn't a very good code of morals because of the atrocities and genocide and et cetera, he will say that that the atrocities are divine judgments and therefore are morally just. And I'm not sure how to explain to him that basically, if you wouldn't hold to them as being moral, how can you say that God is moral in doing it? His simple response to me is that God is perfect and we're not. I'm not sure how to get around that.
So again, he retreats into his unknowable God once you back him into the corner with a question that he can't answer.
You asked a good question, which was, you know, if a man were to do the things that you attribute to your God, we would consider it immoral. So why is it then moral when your God does it? And if his answer is that God's perfect, then it is in fact moral even when a human does it. God doesn't get a special... If he's claiming that it's perfect and perfect morality, then slavery is perfectly moral, no matter who does it. It's not that God's a special case.
Well, gang rape is perfectly moral. Murdering children is perfectly moral. God does all these things in the Old Testament.
Right.
Yeah.
But when you point those things out, it's like, oh, well, that's just the Old Testament.
You know, the funny thing about him, too, and especially when it comes to the dating deal, is right now his story to me is he wants to go into archaeology after he's finished with schooling in order to be a Christian in a field where there's not so many Christians.
Yeah,
because.
And I just find it interesting. I'm pretty convinced that he either won't go into archaeology or won't remain a Christian, or at least maybe a deist. I don't know. But one of the other things that I've been trying to talk to him about are just the different ideas of like string theory and M theory and different possibilities like the accordion universe.
I wouldn't bother. I wouldn't waste a single breath on it.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter. It doesn't even if it gives some pseudo answer that might sound appealing to somebody who's frustrated with not having a better answer than Magic Man done it. Don't waste a minute on it. His beliefs are either true or they're not, and they actually have evidence to support them, or they don't.
The reason why I thought it would be a good way to talk about it is because he's claiming that I believe that the world or the universe came into existence out of nothing, and I've been trying to explain to him that that's not my position, and that I would hold that matter and energy can either be created or destroyed. I would actually lump life into there also, and that whether we know where it came from or we don't know where it came from, it doesn't change the fact that that law is a law, and that he's the one that's trying to say that everything came out of nothing, I'm not sure if I'm getting anywhere.
He may not be. There's a number of different ways to look at Genesis, and one of them has to do with digging down into the language and saying, well, it doesn't say God created from nothing. It says the earth was without form and void, and then God formed it. So they have some sort of apologetic that's still consistent with their text, where God didn't create out of nothing. As a matter of fact, creation ex nihilo has been rejected since Augustine and earlier. It's only a small portion that actually go that route. And that's how they end up twisting this to be consistent with, like, Big Bang cosmology. It's silly. Basically, they had a whole bunch of beliefs that were accepted as literal on the face, this is the way God done it. And then a science comes in and says, ooh, that doesn't make sense. They say, well, you know, okay, but this part's still right. Oh, well, that's not it. Well, this part's still right. And as we start poking holes in it, they basically say, okay, well, that chapter is just a metaphor. It's just an allegory. It's basically the purpose is to tell you not how it was done, but that God's the one who done it. And they keep going that. Well, eventually what they've done and what they'll continue to do is making their God smaller and smaller and more vague as human understanding continues to increase through the reliable scientific method. Yeah. The only way that we know of to get to actual reliable understanding about reality. And eventually they're going to get to a point where they have a God that is as 50% gray as possible.
Well, the point is that we are always going to have, simply because of the nature of it, gaps in our knowledge, knowledge.
And
religion actually loves that. Religion,
science.
Yeah, as you know, Dawkins pointed out in his book, religion loves those gaps because as long as those gaps exist, and they always will, well, those are the gaps that you hide your God in.
And one other thing I wanted to ask about.
Okay, one more, and then we got more callers.
Yeah,
I appreciate it.
Sure.
It's just more on a personal level. Ever since I've found the different teachings of atheism, basically a lot of friends of mine, people who would consider themselves Christians but maybe loose-ended Christians, have basically thought that I've just gone insane. And the reason why I have a problem with this is because I find it, like as Dawkins points out, it's a form of child abuse, and the idea of the irrational is something that is okay within religion, we should respect it. I would agree with him that that's just ridiculous. And it's kind of been a personal thing for me. And how do I deal with the fact that my family members think that I've lost my mind and people I work with don't even want to talk to me and people don't want to go to the bar with me and have a drink because I can't talk about anything else, it seems like.
Well,
I don't know. Like, did you guys ever feel the same way, or is it just...
I got a TV show. I can talk about it as much as I want.
I guess that's true.
I don't really care if people get pissed off or don't want to have a drink with me. More people want to drink with me now because of the show than before. Yeah. First of all, just quick anal retentive corrections. There are no tenets of atheism. There are no teachings of atheism. Atheism isn't an ism. It's a rejection of a position. Everything else is extra. Atheists don't necessarily agree on anything besides that they don't believe that a God exists. So these various things that you're kind of ascribing that have become who you are, and they're not necessarily atheists. They're consistent with atheism, but they aren't derived from atheism because there's nothing to derive from. But with regard to dealing with people, find an atheist group and use that as the outlet to have the type of discussions that other people don't necessarily want to have with you, but be willing to be out and open and honest and have discussions with the people who don't want to go drink with you if that's all you're going to talk about.
Yeah, just like we told the earlier caller who has the same, more or less the same thing. Just, you be the person who's willing to bridge that gap. Right now, they're responding to you because, let's face it, Christianity and religion in general, but Christianity is selling an inferior product. And I think a lot of believers, if you back them up against the court, they know this. And to be faced with someone who just rejects the thing entirely, just said, but just said, look, I just don't believe. I'm not any different of a person. I just don't believe in any of this stuff. But look at you. You're not threatening. You know, you're not someone who is who presents any sort of a challenge to them in any kind of direct way in terms of the way they choose to live their lives.
Curious.
So they're dealing with a lot of confusion right now, and so the way they deal with that confusion is to just sort of retreat. It's there's a lot of fear that's kind of built into the belief process, and they have to sort of overcome that on their own. But you just keep being you,
Right. Thank you, guys.
Sure.
I appreciate you pointing out the fact. I mean, I'm just now trying to understand all these different things. So
hey, that's we're happy to help.
Don't ever stop trying to understand. Thanks a lot for calling, Chris.
Thank you, guys. Bye bye.
We got is it Tim here in Austin?
Tim.
Thank you for waiting, Tim. I can hear the television.
Hello?
That's not Tim, is it?
It's actually Kim.
Kim. Oh,
Kim.
Okay.
They misunderstood you on the typed your name.
Well,
wrong.
Thanks for waiting and clarifying that.
You're on the air.
Well, I'm glad I'm on the air. You know, it took some arguing to get here.
Yeah, well.
Your turn.
What do you want to talk about today?
I want to talk about your topic.
Okay.
Oh, right, that I still haven't gotten to because we've had so much fun with the callers.
Maybe.
Right.
Atheist evangelism.
Word says topic on the screen. Yeah, what about it?
Well, what does that mean to you guys?
Well, I can essentially give the short version of my what I was going to talk about right here. Lately, there have been more exercises by different atheist groups in atheist outreach, which is to say getting the atheist message out to the general public in a more direct way than atheists have done in the past. And I've seen that there have been some effective ways of doing that and some ineffective ways. For example, the American Humanist Association took out ads on buses. There have been signs, billboards placed. And some of these I've thought have been really, really good signs, and others I've thought have been not so good, rather unnecessarily confrontational, when I think that such messages in that context ought to be positive. And shows like this, atheist blogs, atheist books, this is a great forum for being confrontational if it gets there, but the best atheist evangelism that I've seen have been just the general signs that make other unbelievers aware that that they are not alone out in the culture, and that there are other people that they can meet who share their disbelief. And we've already heard from several of our atheist callers today about how when it becomes known to friends of theirs and family members who are believers that they are an atheist, those people shut them out and are very unfriendly to them and hostile to them and reject them. And
well,
they're a little confused
with
that. And so so this is a way we've seen lately that atheist groups are doing
a
lot more
outreach.
Okay. All right.
You may want to actually turn the TV down and just pay attention to the phone because there's a delay and it gets really distracting. But yeah, go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right. So your question is?
Well, my question is, if you are an atheist evangelist, then why are you trying to spread something as a religion?
Well,
if you don't believe in a religion.
We're not.
I use the term evangelism in just sort of a casual, colloquial way, but it's a way of meaning getting the message out there to atheists at large that there are other people like them out there. Just sort of letting other people know about atheists.
Okay,
atheism
well, that's
in general.
Great. But here's the problem. I have been raised. I have a brother who is a Southern Baptist pastor for an independent fundamental Baptist church.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So my question is not necessarily why should I continue to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, but why you as an atheist should tell me that you're right, because at this time I'm kind of at an impasse. Like, you know, maybe you're right, maybe my brother's right.
Here's the thing. It's just in the way you phrase that, it kind of gets me to the point, and I'll hit it as quick as I can. I'm a lot like your brother in that I was going to be a Southern Baptist pastor, but the question isn't the assertion isn't that we're right. It's the position here is that the case for your brother's God has not been made, that there is insufficient evidence.
But there is scientific proof, and I'm not not credible. Wait. I'm not credible to argue this with you, but I have been to conferences.
Hang
on just a second. You say there's scientific evidence or proof of what?
The fact that we are not millions and millions of years old.
Okay, hang on. And then you say that you're not qualified to argue that case, correct?
I did say I'm not qualified, but you asked me, why am I not qualified to argue?
Then why do you believe it? If you are
unable... That's my question. That's why I want you to tell me why I'm wrong for believing that
why do you think that there is credible scientific evidence for the idea that the Earth is not millions of years old? What scientific evidence do you think there is?
Here we go into where I don't have all of the information.
Then if you don't have all the information, you need to understand that, and you need to not go around saying things like, there is this proof.
I am not saying that there is a proof.
You just said your topic is
atheist evangelism.
I know, right? but we're trying to get you.
My question to you is, am I wrong? And
yes.
If I am wrong, tell me believing that I'm an atheist will make me free make me feel better.
There's no nothing about believing that you're an atheist. There's nothing. I happen to find atheism particularly freeing of the mind. But there's no assertions of that. The only thing is that there's no justification for believing in a God. At least it's so far as I know. And when you talk about your position, you said that there's scientific proof, even though you can't present it, that the Earth is not millions of years old. Well, you're kind of correct in a way, because it's billions of years old, about 4.5 billions of years old. And if you actually go and study the science, you can discover this on your own, rather than saying, somebody told me that the Earth isn't millions of years old and that they have scientific proof for it, and so I'm going to believe them. That is not the scientific consensus. It's not remotely. Matter of fact, that particular idea is laughed out.
Where would I find the scientific evidence that you are referring to?
TalkOrigins.org.
There are any number of...
Geology books?
Yeah. There are...
Eighth grade geology books?
There are big universities in this country that teach these courses.
As an atheist, do you feel more free in your lifestyle? Do you feel like it doesn't really matter what you do? Do you have morals or ethics?
Yes.
Of course.
Really? And what are they based upon?
They're based upon reason. They're based upon the fact that we're higher thinking beings and that we understand what it takes to succeed as such. What we're trying to get you to understand, and this is what we were harping on earlier on when you weren't sort of letting us respond to you, which is, if you want to understand what is correct to believe in your life, you first need to learn to be more consistent in your thinking. You need to learn to understand that you can't go around saying in the same sentence, there is scientific proof for X, but I don't know what it is, or but I can't defend it. You need to not, because essentially you're holding on right now to some very contradictory ideas in your head, and you're trying to sort of make them coalesce. And I think the reason is, you just really haven't learned to sort of streamline your thinking and to understand, if I'm going to hold to a certain position, I need to be able to defend that position. If I'm going to say there is scientific evidence for X, I need to have studied that so that I can say there's scientific evidence for X. Otherwise, I'm just like somebody...
I have no disagreement with you on that at all. That wasn't even my... again, we're going back to the reason I initially called was the topic is atheist evangelism.
Yes.
Right. And that's, and I kind of explained.
I haven't heard anybody tonight touch on that topic.
That's because we didn't get there.
Yeah, we've just been talking to callers.
Like, here I am asking you to get there. Okay.
Well,
maybe
I
just for my own personal reasons, I need to believe that maybe a God doesn't exist.
Well,
but
see, that's
not the way I have been raised for 35 years.
That's not the case either. It's not. I happen to believe that no gods exist, but that's not atheism. That's strong atheism. That's a different.
What is atheist evangelism then?
I'm
confused.
Okay, I talked about it earlier, but in case you missed it, I'll say it again. There have recently been a number of atheist groups who have been actively promoting the atheist message in a public form where it hasn't been presented before, through things like billboards, bus ads, signs out on public property next to nativity scenes, which I think it was actually a bad idea. But the long and short of it is, there has been more of an effort along these lines, and it has really riled up a number of Christian groups and believers. But the main point of it is that a great many atheists in our culture, there are people who are unbelievers who don't know any other atheists. They feel isolated. We've had a lot of callers tonight say these things. I decided I didn't believe in God, and suddenly my friends wouldn't talk to me. My coworkers wouldn't talk to me. My family shuts me out. What do I do? A lot of people out there, this is what, finally, when you get on the other side of the religious fence, you realize how divisive religion is.
Oh, no, I realize how divided it is.
Yeah. The atheist, when you talk about evangelism, all I'm really talking about is the way that these certain atheist groups, they can be local, they can be nationwide, groups like Freedom From Religion Foundation, have recently begun doing things like advertising campaigns to just kind of get the message out there.
My question to you is, why would you want to argue with someone who may or may not believe?
Okay, stop.
Well, that's a different issue.
Hang on. You don't want to know what atheist evangelism is. You want to know about atheism and why any atheist would bother to talk about atheism. You're exactly right.
I do. And that's what the evangelism part comes into, because we're talking about broadcasting over television.
Hang on. Where it says topic and the thing after it, that's specifically something Martin wanted to talk about. So you're not wanting to talk about Martin's topic. You're wanting to talk about what atheism is and why anybody would want to go around advocating it in the first place.
I got you, and
I'll be happy to answer it. Do you think that it's a good thing for people to be taking heroin all the time?
Absolutely not.
Okay.
Do you believe that it's good?
No. Would you be willing to, I don't know, speak out against that?
A simple yes or no question, Kim.
Would you be willing to speak out against that?
Okay.
So would I. I believe, first of all, I'm an atheist, which means that I am unconvinced that any of the God claims are true. I see no reason to believe any of them are true. I don't believe them. I reject them. I actually go a step further, and I actually believe there aren't any gods, but that's a separate thing. I'm in a position where I remain unconvinced of the various God claims, and I think that I have reasons to point out where those beliefs are leading to actions which are harmful, and that some of the specific beliefs are untrue. I care enough because I was a fundamentalist Christian for 20 some odd years and was going to be a minister, and I believed these things that I now think.
And what changed that?
Sorry?
What changed that?
I'm getting there. I believed those things that I now consider to be untrue for a very long time, and I no longer believe them, and I'd like to tell other people that I no longer believe them, and perhaps help some of those other people who are in a position similar free themselves from the shackles of religion. What caused me to stop believing, number one, was a detailed study of the Bible, an analysis and consideration of the objections that other atheists and skeptics had launched against Christianity in particular and religion in general, a study of philosophy, a study of science, a broadening of my own understanding about the reality of the world, such that my old beliefs not only no longer made any sense, but were clearly wrong. They could not be supported by reason or evidence.
Well, it sounds like I'm similar to you at this point in my life. I don't know how old you are, but I am looking for something that is actually the truth.
Yeah.
I didn't call to really argue,
no,
but you hit the nail on the head when I said, yes, I am calling based on what your topic says. atheist evangelism, because to me that says, hey, I'm reaching out to you and I want you to know the truth.
Here's the thing, and because we only got like 20 minutes left and there's other callers on here, there's two things. One, you can email tv@atheist-community.org. I forgot to mention this in the announcement, so I wanted to make sure I got it in there. For anybody, for any reason, you can email tv@atheist-community.org. That goes to myself, the co-host, some of the people behind the scenes. Number two, you're here in Austin, right, Kim?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
Actually, Cedar Park.
Yeah, well, then it's quite a hike. But not only are you welcome to come to any of our events, including dinner after the show tonight at Threadgills, but you can come down to the studio and watch the show live. You can meet up at the lectures. If you email, I'm not out here. My purpose isn't necessarily to deconvert people, to drag them away from the religion, but for people who are genuinely interested in having the discussion and considering other options, those are the people that I want to talk to, both on the show and in person. So, I mean, you can email questions or topics for discussion, anything, and we'll be happy to address them.
Yeah.
All right. So are you going to display that on the screen?
Yep.
Yeah, sure, right at the bottom of the screen.
But I want to make one caveat. The first thing you got to get used to and get comfortable with is I don't know. Because atheism isn't an ism. It's not a set of beliefs. It's not a tenet. So there's no tenets, no dogma, no nothing. And there's no assertion that we have answers, that we are the right ones, that we have come to some grand understanding of the universe and we're right and they're wrong. It's an application of reason that says we don't know. We know what we know, and we don't know what we don't know, and we're not necessarily okay with that. We are accepting that that is the current state, but we are constantly striving to find out the things that we don't know. And the best way to do this, the only way that anybody's ever demonstrated it with any reliability, is through the use of logic, reason, evidence, and the scientific method. That's it. Faith, praying, hoping, wishing, casting lots, none of that gets people any closer to truth in any kind of reliable sense.
It might give you emotional comfort, but it doesn't really...
Yeah, I care more about whether or not my beliefs are true than whether or not they feel
good. And how
often
do you guys broadcast?
Every Sunday.
This is the first time I've actually caught this show.
Yeah, we're on every Sunday from 4:30 to 6 on Channel 16 in Austin and streamed over the internet. We also do a podcast geared for atheists every other Saturday from 2 to 3:30 p.m. And that'll be live again on the 10th, starting the new season.
So, all right. Well, thank you, guys.
Hey, thank you.
Thanks, Kim.
Thanks a lot.
No problem.
Take care.
Have a good one.
Yeah, you too. Have a good New Year.
Yeah.
You had to kind of pin
her down. The topic is misleading because we didn't get to it.
Yeah.
It's for somebody who'd never seen the show before, it's not going to be easy to understand that, Martin wants to talk about specifically the types of atheist evangelism.
Right.
And the caller wants to know, what's atheism and why are you doing any of it?
I guess you guys can take the topic sign because I've talked about it now, more or less. But but we've only got 18 minutes in the show left, and so it's going to be on to callers now. So.
Want to get to some more callers? We've got Lynn here in Austin.
Yes, sir.
How are you, Lynn?
I'm fine, thanks. As you may recall, I've called a couple of times before, mm-hmm. and always before it was to agree with you, and I definitely consider myself atheist-friendly. But I disagree with your idea attitude or action has ever been inspired by religion, which is not basically selfish, and you asked us to give examples of unselfish acts inspired by religion. So I was going to give you a couple of them.
That's not quite what I was asking.
But let her. Yeah,
I fully admit that people, for religious reasons and for other things, have done unselfish things. My particular objection went to the core motivation for religious pursuits in the first place. People do, and I said a while ago, people do plenty of good things in the name of religion and not in the name of religion.
Yeah. And again, and also, to suggest that something is a selfish activity doesn't mean that it's selfish in the way that you might think of the very worst examples of selfishness a human being can exhibit, right?
Yeah, because I don't consider selfish to be a dirty word or even negative.
I mean, a person can do something, and whether they do it because they're motivated by their religious belief or whether they do it just simply because they're an altruist, a person can do something, let's say they feed the homeless for a day, right? Well, there is the altruistic nature of, okay, you fed the homeless, and that's great, and you've done a good thing for them, but a lot of people who do those things also do it because they get a personal sense of gratification for having done those things. They feel like they've done some good, and that makes them happy. Now, in a sense, you're getting something out of it. Now, just because the very nature of that kind of selfishness is not, you know, in and of itself evil, right? It's not an evil sort of selfishness. But to a certain degree, we do everything that we do in our lives because, you know, hopefully because there's the pursuit of some pleasure or some gain.
But I want to go ahead and let you talk, Lynn. I just want to make sure that you were clear that I didn't think religious people never did anything altruistic or good or non-selfish.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
In the name of religion, you mean. Well, that's all right. Since the time is getting late, I won't bother to give the examples, except people have helped me sometimes, even at inconvenience to themselves,
yeah,
and said things like, if I thank them, they'd say, well, I wouldn't be much of a Christian if I didn't, or whatever their religion is.
Yeah, and I'd say they wouldn't be much of a human being if they didn't, and that they're just projecting their Christianity onto natural human behavior.
Well, that's very interesting, but so many people don't go out of their way to help other people at inconvenience to themselves.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, it's there are, you'll find nice Christians and mean and indifferent Christians. You'll find nice atheists and you'll find mean and indifferent atheists. You'll find nice Hindus and mean and indifferent ones.
Are you the nice one and I'm the mean and indifferent one today? Or which one is it? Good atheist, bad atheist?
Call it in the air.
All right. Well, thanks, Lynn. I appreciate the call.
Oh, you're welcome. Thanks. Happy New Year, everybody.
Happy New Year to you.
Happy New Year to you, too.
Have a very safe one.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Yeah, the thing is that, you know, we've had, and there's a good chance that the ACA will be doing more charity and social beneficial work in the future. Mm-hmm. Well, we've done some in the past, and, you know, every Sunday down at the overpass, by 6th and 7th Street, there's a church service, and they get all the homeless people down there and they feed them. They're not the only ones. There are ACA members who have, out of their own pocket, gone down there and fed them. And I'm not, I don't want to say, the fact of the matter is, people do things, and sometimes they do good things, and sometimes they do bad things, and sometimes those things seem nastily selfish, and sometimes they seem altruistic. And sometimes they do it in the name of religion, and sometimes they don't.
Yeah.
What I'm not a fan of is the people who would assert that the only way to get something good is to do it
through religion.
Right. The fact of the matter is, no one, in the entire time that I've been doing this show, in emails, in conversations, on websites, no one has yet to provide a single example of a real, tangible, positive benefit that can only be achieved through religion. Not one. Oh, sure, well, you're not going to get to heaven without religion. But that's not a real, tangible, that's just a claim. You can't demonstrate that you're going to get to heaven or hell either way. I'm talking about what positive benefit is there to human beings right now that can only be achieved by religion. And nobody has met that challenge. I've had a steak dinner up on that one for 3 years now, and nobody can meet the challenge. You know why? Because there isn't one. You don't have to do an exhaustive search to figure this out. You can figure it out with just a few minutes and a little exercise of reason. And that, and yet these people who, I'll go ahead and say it, particularly fundamentalist Christians, have this idea that if you're not religious, you can't be a good person unless you're just kind of pretending to be a good person, or unless the Christian morals have flooded over onto you and forced you to be good. The fact of the matter is that your religion has been dragged kicking and screaming out of the Dark Ages and the Bronze Ages and all those other ages where you're doing all kinds of immoral stuff, and it was secular reasoning. It was the advent of human liberty and freedom and equality that forced your religion to give up slavery, to start allowing equal rights for women, to come out and take your blinders off and be part of the real humanity. President-elect Obama has decided that Rick Warren is going to give his inauguration address, and this has been the subject of a lot of conversation. And I will say right now, I've gone back and forth on the issue. On the one hand, it's not James Dobson. On the other hand, it's not Fred Phelps. On the other hand, Rick Warren has a lot of ideas that are exactly the same as Fred Phelps's. He just colors them in nicer language. He's anti-atheist, doesn't think an atheist can be a president. I need to tell him, Mr. Warren, you should go read Article 6 of the U.S. Constitution that says there'll be no religious test for any public office or trust. And then tell me that an atheist can't be a good president, or shouldn't be president at all. I don't know. What are you defining as good? he's anti-gay, but he'll stand there with a bunch of gay people and tell them he likes them right before he goes out and tries to lobby to get their rights taken away because it disagrees with his personal religious beliefs. Guess what? You do not get to foist your personal morality or your personal religious beliefs on the rest of the people in the country. We do not live in a Christian nation in that sense, Mr. Warren. We live in a Christian nation that is 75 to 80% Christian. Saying that we're a Christian nation is like saying that we're a female nation or a white nation, and I don't hear you doing that because somebody would kick your butt. I've gone back and forth on this because I realize that from a political aspect, it's a good call. It's a good call because atheists, we don't really matter. In a political scheme, we don't. We're a small minority. They don't need to pander to us at all. And, you know, you need to throw a bone to the religious right as the new liberal, ultra-liberal president coming in so that maybe...
Yeah, but the religious right doesn't like Warren either, really.
So that maybe you can get a little bit more done with your legislative agenda. However, that's not the case. You won with a mandate. You have the political clout already. You don't need to kowtow to anybody. And there were plenty of better ecumenical choices that could have conformed to your own Christian views and not alienated you from rational, secular people. I haven't become an anti-Obama person. I despise Rick Warren. But I understand.
Yeah, Rick Warren is a dimwit.
I understand the choice. I just don't happen to agree with it.
Well, it is pandering in that I think Warren was only chosen due to his celebrity.
Yes.
Right? I mean, that was, you know, they needed a...
It's purpose-driven life.
Yeah. Ooh. And, you know, but his actually, you talk about pandering to the religious right. If that was the goal, that was a major flub because they hate him even worse than we do.
Well,
you know, Rick Warren practiced... On the one hand, yes, he does actually share a lot of the ideological... points of view that
it didn't fail. It didn't remotely fail. I got home, and the first thing out of all of my religious, ultra-conservative family members' mouths was how happy they were that Obama picked Rick Warren because they love and respect Rick Warren.
Okay, well, that may be the truth. But I get a lot of the newsletters and the emails from some of the real wingnut right-wing Christian sites where they, you know, Rick Warren practices this sort of Oprah-friendly, you know, form of touchy-feely, warm, fuzzy Christianity light that the real fire and brimstone crowd doesn't like. And there's a lot
of contempt. Fire and brimstone. He just chocolate coats.
Well, yeah, precisely. And they don't think it should be coated. They think it's, you know, fire and brimstone and burn the gays, and that's
but
all.
But no president is going to pick Fred Phelps.
But here's the thing, though. At the same time, all right, Obama did this, and I'm disappointed by the choice, but I think that a lot of Obama supporters probably, you know, there have been such high expectations, and I think maybe some people have gotten some unrealistically high expectations about Obama's presidency. And look, the guy he's a human being. He's going to make mistakes as a president. His administration will be full of decisions that even his most ardent supporters are disappointed by, just as much as they will be decisions he'll make that we'll all be very happy with. You know, he's going to make us happy. He's going to disappoint us. He's going to have great successes. He's going to have big screw-ups. Overall, I hope he's a really good president, but I think that there is too much of a tendency, I think, with his presidency for people to have these, Obama, you know.
Yeah, we generally avoid politics on the show for a lot of reasons, but I don't want to come off as being unfair and not pointing out things I disagree with from people that I otherwise would like. We have 6 minutes, so we want to...
Talk to Joe. Let's
try and knock some of this out real as quick as we can. Joe from Los Angeles, you're on the air.
Hey, how's it going?
Good.
Thanks for waiting.
I don't want to take up too much more time if there's other people on the phone. But I'm in a club at my school, UCLA.
Okay.
And we're called Bruin Alliance of Skeptics and Secularists. And we promote our club in a way where we go on this place called Bruin Walk. Sorry, I'm really nervous.
Don't be.
And I'll be really fast. We go on this place called Bruin Walk where other clubs promote their club, and we put up a big sign that says, Ask an Atheist.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And I like to argue with people, and I thought a lot of people would come up and argue. But instead, a lot of people came up and said, hey, I didn't know there was this club on our campus, and it's been more of a positive thing.
Good.
But, and the issue I have with it is that it says ask an atheist, and I'm afraid that it's making people who aren't necessarily atheists go away from our club, and that it kind of looks like we're doing it just to get attention.
Well, all the other, well, in a sense you are, right? But what's wrong? Every club on Bruin Walk is trying to get attention to, for their club, right? That's the point of it. You're trying to promote your club. So
yeah.
In that regard, there's nothing wrong with that. But you can't control what everyone will think and how everyone will react. As you said, you've gotten a lot of people out there who have seen the sign, gone, oh, wow, an atheist group, and you've met some folks, and I didn't know there was a group here, and da-da-da-da, and you've had good conversations. So there you've had the positive experience. A few people might go, ugh. You know, fine, you can't do anything about that. Just accept. It sounds like you're having really great success with it, and just bask in that.
Are you, Joe, the leader of the group at all, or?
I'm the vice president.
And what's it called? What's the group called?
It's called the Bruin Alliance of Skeptics and Secularists.
Okay.
Base.
Okay, this is a huge debate that's gone on with every group that I've heard of forming. It happened with the UT group, it happened with the group at ETSU and other things. If you formed a group that's like the atheist free thought group or the atheist secular agnostic free, what label do we use when we're out talking about it? In your case, with your group, since the group doesn't mention atheist in the name, it may go against kind of what the general feeling of the group was. So it may not be the best usage in your case. In my position, not only am I in the atheist community of Austin, but the groups that I deal with, if atheist is in the name and somebody objects to the A word, get over it. Because one of my biggest purposes is to do whatever I can to alleviate the stigma that and the baggage that comes along with the A word. Just saying atheist drives people to ooh and cower in fear, and you're some kind of you're a scary thing, or our preacher told us you're evil, or you're out to destroy America, or you kill babies or rape nuns, or the stories just kind of get piled on until you're spun as that kind of evil thing. And I'm saying I'm an atheist, and that means that I don't believe in God. You want to try and convince me, feel free. I do this for entirely rational reasons. I'm not only not ashamed of the label, I'll wear it all the time. But I will acknowledge that the label isn't right for every person in every group. And there are some real dangers and real risks. There are people who write and say, I'm afraid to come out as an atheist because I know if I say I'm an atheist, I'm going to lose my job. In that case, I say, don't say you're an atheist. Let somebody else who is not the slightest bit concerned about it, let me be the front runner and Martin and those other people who are saying, we're atheists and we don't care. You take my job away, maybe we'll have an issue. But if you're living in an area where it's not safe for you as an individual, or for your family, or your career, or your group, if it's an uncomfortable situation, don't use the label. Let somebody else use it.
All right. Well, the thing is, we had a discussion about it, and we agreed the same thing that you said, and that was initially my stance. Yeah, you are right. I agree. And the only thing is, hello?
I got to cut you off, Joe, because we only have 45 seconds left.
Sorry about that.
That's all right. That's all right. Thanks for calling. To the other people who are on, there's the list of the crew. They can show themselves. Oh, they're just showing.
Muhammad,
you didn't make it into the studio. We'll be back again next week. I have no idea who's going to be on, but we'll be streaming again. Anybody who wants can join us down at Threadgills.
And it looks
shortly.
Like the chat room was on fire today because they're over here.
Jen's on fire.
Yeah, they're
we'll be down. We'll be down at Threadgills around 6 o'clock. Anybody, any atheist or atheist-friendly person is welcome to join us. Email tv@atheist-community.org and visit the website for more information and the frequently asked questions page. We'll see you next week. Okay, so now we're just on with the internet people.
Really?
Hi, internet people.
Hello. Hi. How are
Hang
you
on.
Guys?
Is this John from Austin?
Yeah, buddy.
I ran out of time, man. Sorry.
But we'll still talk to you.
It's all right. I'm watching you on the stream.
you can have a minute or two before we start packing up.
Sweet. I had a question. About deism rather than theism. I know you guys are atheists. I also am an atheist.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm on the fence about deism.
Yeah.
Would you consider yourself an atheist as well? You probably would, right?
Yeah.
So, would you say that there's any reason that a person who is an intelligent person, who thinks critically and logically, could say, like, we don't know enough about how the universe began or something like that, not that necessarily, but something like that, that there might be room
yeah.
to fit in a deistic God?
Yeah, I can see how that can happen, but they're wrong. Because what they're saying is we don't know enough, so this is possible, so I'm going to go ahead and accept it. And what I would say is we don't know enough. It may or may not be possible. We don't know enough to know if it's possible. And so I'm not going to accept it until there's a good reason to do so.
Yeah, see, the wisest choice is always to refrain from making any kind of a knowledge claim, you know, in the absence of evidence. Lots of things are possible. You know, the universe could be the result of a theistic God or a deistic God. The universe could have been farted out of the ass of Gus the Magic Cosmic Hippo, right? We don't know these things, it's true. But, you know, the time to say, I think this is the reason that there is a universe, is when the evidence, you know, that can be verified points to that conclusion, and really not before. And otherwise, really, the only sensible thing to say in response to things that you don't know is, I don't know the answer to this.
And the best case I've ever heard for any kind of deistic argument is some variation of a first cause. And the point that they get to is they make the leap, I guess, that there must have been some kind of cause, and no matter what it was, we're going to call it God. And we're going to look at it as a deistic, non-intervention. Well, you don't know that it, even if you were to discover that there had to be a first cause, you don't know that it's intelligent. You don't know that it was any kind of personage. You don't know that it was any kind of creative force or any kind of transcendent or supernatural force. What justification do you have if you don't know anything at all about it to make any kind of label for that, especially to apply something like deism, which, even though it talks about a non-intervention starter God that may or may not even exist anymore, it's still making assertions about the nature of the thing it's talking about while simultaneously saying we don't know anything about it.
Okay. I appreciate the ammo, because I get that. I, as I said, I'm an atheist, and I get that question all the time when talking to creationists, so I appreciate the ammo there.
Sure.
Hey, yeah, and and email us anytime if we can help with anything else.
Thanks, John.
Absolutely. I think you guys rock. Okay,
thanks, John.
I'll see you next week.
You rock, too, for thinking we rock.
Yes.
Matt.
Yeah?
The chat room is screaming about your book.
What book?
You're supposed to be writing a book.
I started three of them, but did they really think that they were going to get one, like, before the first of the year or something?
No, they want to know when it's going to be published.
Who knows?
When he finishes...
I'll have more time to work on it now that Russell's doing one show a month as host, so I have a weekend off. That works out. Hey, Matt from Denton.
Hey, yeah, I talked to you once before.
Yeah, you got 30 seconds.
Okay, up here in Denton, Ray Comfort works with the Good News Network on these Jesus $1 million bills. Have you ever seen them?
For fuck's sake.
Good old Ray, our buddy Ray.
Can I come up? Is Ray in Denton very often?
I don't know, but I know he works with this company. And they make these $1 million bills.
Yeah,
they
were busted.
Talk about Jesus, all that bullshit.
Yeah.
And I want to make an atheist bill, maybe like a euro, because all the, like, Norway, Sweden, they're all, like, mostly secular nations, and they have way better standards of living. We can kind of tell them about atheists.
I'd be cautious about that, and here's why. Living Waters Ministries, which is Ray Comfort's place, which was printing up those $1 million bills, was raided, and those bills were confiscated.
I read
illegal.
About that.
Yeah.
I know.
It's hilarious.
Yeah. I actually still have one. Actually, it's at home. I don't have it in my wallet, but I got it at home.
Yeah, but I mean, it would be a euro, so I don't see why the Secret Service would raid my apartment or whatever.
Scotland Yard would come kick your door down.
Interpol.
Yeah,
door.
That's better.
Yeah.
That's better. All right, thanks, man.
Cool. Thanks a lot. All right. Wow.
I don't know. It's no more screening, so I don't know who's on. Who are we talking
product
to?
Placement.
Right. Hey, Matt.
Yes.
Hi, Matt. It's George in New York.
Yes, it's George. How you doing, buddy?
Hello, Martin, as well. Oh, Martin, by the way. Mm-hmm. Gus is not a hippo. He's an alligator. You're an apostate, and we can only settle this through violence.
Them's fighting words.
Can we thumb wrestle?
Yeah, that'll... Well, I have to check the synod. So I'll get back to you. It's in committee.
All right.
Anyway, I just wanted to mention that regarding our friend, the Reverend Warren.
Yes.
Dr. Robert M. Price, the Bible geek of fame, has done a nice takedown of him in both online blog form and in print with his own book, The Reason-Driven Life.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I was going to mention that.
Written by him as a Bible scholar, against a purpose-driven life. So if you haven't checked it out, anyone listening to this, please do. It's a good bit. And if you want a sample of it, check the blog out, the Reason-Driven Life blog.
Yeah, I have a copy of it, but I haven't dug it out of my pile yet. So it's on my to-read stack, along with John Loftus's book and Neil Shubin's book and all the rest of them. But are aware of it. But, you're right. It's a good thing to bring up to people that there is a response to his drivel out there.
I meant to mention it, but every call and every response from either of us seemed to be going on forever. Everybody was long-winded today, I thought.
Yeah, but we have some good.
That's what Christmas will do to you.
I guess so. Well, I have to burn those carbs somehow. I don't exercise. I don't mean to be a pest about this, but Bob Price, can we get him on the show?
On nonprofits, yeah. I'm going to actually... Bob's going to be on nonprofits, and so's John Loftus. I'm doing a couple of... I may try and do them... I won't say when, because every time I say when, I screw up and I don't get around to it.
Okay.
But it's planned.
All right, good show, guys. I'll use my usual sign-off for the Horde. Take care.
Take care, man.
For the Alliance.
Alliance!
Except for the people who've canceled their accounts.
Okay,
who's left? You're on the air.
Hello?
Yes. Yeah, hi.
Awesome, I made it through.
Yeah, yeah. You're the last guy. What's up?
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. I just wanted to kind of call for... I've been seeing you guys on the internet. I think it's really an interesting show, and it really sparks a lot of great conversation. I guess I just kind of wanted to call. I'm not really sure where it's going to end up, but... I'm kind of I see the both sides of someone who's theist as well as like atheist. I mean, I could, especially when somebody has good points to make, and I'm listening to both sides, I guess. One thing that I just kind of wanted to talk about was like, you guys kind of believe in the Big Bang, right? Like we all came from.
Yeah, well, I think kind of.
The theory, that we all kind of came from one maybe like singular event, or no one's really exactly
sure. Well, I think it would be more accurate to say that we accept that the Big Bang is, at the present time, the scientific theory that has the best evidence to support it for why our universe is the way it is.
Okay.
I would refrain. The word, I have a trouble using the word belief because it's so frequently, when you use it in a religious context, which is when it's most frequently used, it tends to imply this is a thought in my head that I'm just not going to get rid of no matter what. And hey, if there is some scientific evidence tomorrow... For Gus the Magic Cosmic Hippo, then fine, I'll be happy to throw the Big Bang overboard. But right now, that's kind of where we stand. The Big Bang is the Big Bang. It's kind of the best idea science has got at the moment.
Right on. Okay, I totally understand that. And that's kind of how I operate too. It's like, I'm kind of skeptical to really believe something without continuing to question and look into stuff. Mm-hmm. And I guess it's just like with the Big Bang, it kind of like gives us the idea that we all came from like one thing, and we could understand better tomorrow, but essentially we're all one in a way, because we all kind of came from like the same source. And so it kind of just makes me think, well, if we all came from the same source, and the universe has been evolving since that point in time and progressing and now it's like still in this kind of like these same cycles, it takes 365 days to go around the sun or whatever, and 24 hours to spin around. It's all kind of timed out, and it just kind of makes me think we're still kind of all one, and we're part of the larger cosmos. As it evolves and it grows and it expands and progresses, that that humans are kind of progressing and expanding and evolving along with it. And it's not like we're somehow separate.
We're definitely part of the cosmos and everything's changing, but if you mean it in any kind of metaphysical sense and that we're like, some kind of cosmic connection on some level,
it's very easy with thinking those kinds of thoughts to suddenly like kind of teeter over the edge into sort of new aginess,
which
you want to avoid. But if you want to talk prosaically, sure, yeah. I mean, we're all made of star stuff, and we're natural beings, and we're all part of the natural universe, and that's great.
Mm-hmm.
But there's no real reason to attach any more significance.
It's like Woodstock, the song where it starts off with "We are stardust." Mm-hmm. I'm there, but we got to get ourselves back to the garden. I'm not there.
Right.
Yeah. And remember also, you know, it is very true, and it will always be true, we don't know everything about our universe and our natures, right? I mean, we can only go back to the origin of the universe to a certain point,
right,
beyond which we are just like, our knowledge evaporates, and then the universe continues to surprise us, right? I mean, the whole expansion of the universe.
Yeah.
You know, like traditionally, the Big Bang would say, okay, it went bang, and then now it's spreading, it should be slowing down. Well, recently we found it's not slowing down. The expansion
it's accelerating,
of the universe,
right?
It's accelerating, right? We don't know why that's happening. So all this new stuff.
And it could be the case that the laws of physics are localized.
Yeah. Or it was just a mighty big fart from little Gus. You know?
See, the big thing here is that, and this actually, and I gotta say this, and then we gotta cut it off.
I'm done.
Okay.
Because there are people waiting for dinner.
Five viewers.
And I forgot what I was gonna say.
Did that on purpose.
Nice. Can I just say a couple quick things that I just want to kind of like put towards, like, I know there's all this, like, crazy skepticism and, you know...
Skepticism?
Well, not only that, not crazy. And I don't mean that as a insult, because both religious people or, you know, other people who are staunch, everybody could be crazy, including me, so it doesn't mean
anything. You got, like, 30 seconds, and they're going to kick me out.
All right, I just want to say, first of all, with, like, Christianity, I'm not a religious, but I just want to say, like, the original message with Christianity was universal salvation and universal reconciliation. And
no.
The whole fire and brimstone thing is kind of something that
no
has developed.
Actually, the original message of Christianity wasn't universal salvation. That's something new.
It's not. From my research, it's basically that it's not new. It's that it comes from, like, first few hundred years, like, the original Christian groups all kind of were into more of the, you know, Christ, his point, I don't even, you know, was to save mankind and not, like, we have, like, one individual believer has the power to, like, decide everything, but more like that was the original point. And I couldn't embrace Christianity at all until I heard that.
Yeah.
I'll put it that way. Like, I don't know where, you know, exactly, but I'm just saying I couldn't even tolerate or fathom the idea of a God that would, like, burn someone forever. I mean, that's just like...
That's still a part of it. Even if you think that that there's some goodness to a message of Christianity that is universal salvation available to everybody, you still haven't gotten over the problem of fundamental problem of Christianity, of why anybody needs saving in the first place, and why you could call a God good who's going to torture anybody.
Right on. I would say the only point for any of that would be, like, corrective. Like, if you're going to go through some kind of suffering, it would have to be corrective as opposed to just, like, some sadistic...
But what was the reason for making anything in the first place if it was going to go wrong?
I would say the intention, I don't know, not to go wrong, and I would say it would be more to just kind of...
On some level, no matter what kind of story you spin, and no matter how soft you make the Christianity or whatever religion it is, there's something fundamentally flawed at some level.
You know what I agree
and I
to,
find
and I
it.
Think it's awesome that you guys are taking a stance against that. That's all.
I got to let you go, man. They're going to kick us out right now.
Okay, cool. And 2012-13 is about evolution, not the end of the world. Thanks. That's all I got to say. Thanks, guys.
What was that? Is that more of that Mayan calendar 2112 crap?